Let me just quickly introduce this panel, the reason, and I want to thank Aphrodite for having set up the panel so quickly with Fabio and with the speakers. The reason why we're organizing this panel is that we have a partnership with the Swiss Confederation on organizing hackathons for aging and disabilities in relation with the big challenges in Asia Pacific. That's why we have invited four speakers that I'm going to quickly introduce. First, we're going to have Marta Perez-Cuzo, who is the Economic Affairs Officer at UNSCAP, which is the Economic and Social Commission for Asia Pacific for the United Nations, who is going to tell us more about inclusive innovation for disabilities. Then we will have really the chance to have Maggie Goody, who is the president of Andy Capable, but most importantly, she's the mother of Emma that you see in the picture. Emma has participated twice to the hackathon Hacker Health, which is one very nice hackathon that is occurring in Geneva. She will tell us a bit more about it and what is the experience from a parent of a disabled person perspective. And we are also very honored to have Najme Khalili Mahan from Concordia University. We don't know each other, Najme, but I'm very, very much looking forward what you're going to tell us about media and technology for resilience and aging in aging. And last but not least, Bettina Ferdman, who is the head of development and innovation at Fondation Fides, which is a newborn foundation in Geneva. Which goal is to foster innovation for social enterprises.
So when I moved to Bangkok, I wanted to explore how we could promote science, technology, and innovation policies that will bring more inclusive outcomes and really support this transformative agenda of the UN of leaving no one behind. And so that was the question, why are we innovating? We started exploring what were some of the experiences in Asia and what could be different means and mechanisms to promote innovation that will have more inclusive outcomes. And one of the first messages is we have to see from when we promote innovations for the poor versus when we promote innovations by the poor. Those are two very different and complementary approaches on how one may want to think about developing innovations for different marginalized groups. And we don't have particular experience on the area of disability. It's an area we've explored in one workshop, and we've had a couple of opportunities to interact. And I will just want to share with you some of those thoughts that we had behind what it means to promote innovations for persons with disability. And here it's first, how do we define disability? And when we talk about disabilities, and we had the pleasure to have a very good internal training for UN staff at ESCAP on disabilities, because at the global UN level, the Secretary General is promoting supporting a strategy for inclusion of persons with disability within the UN. And in this training that was provided by Peter Tan, he made a very good explanation of what's a person with disability. And it's not simply a person that has some physical or mental impairment. We talk of disability when there's the attitudinal and environmental barriers that prevent that person from leading a full life and to have agency. So it's not because a person is in a wheelchair that cannot fully leads its life. It's because also the environmental context that we face, and also stigma and other attitudinal barriers that persons with disability face. And this came up very clearly from our workshop that we had on technology and innovation for persons with disability. In Asia, there is a very strong stigma for persons with disability. That's the message that I could hear very loud and clear. So if you want to innovate, if you want to develop, to innovate for persons with disability, it's not just about the technological solution, but it's also about addressing those environmental barriers and attitudinal barriers. Now, on the other dimension, I would like to reinforce the point that I made about two approaches for how we innovate for marginalized groups. And one way is to bring solutions to those marginalized groups. One could be persons with disability. And the other way of thinking about that is also about involving persons with disability in having an agency to develop also solutions. We are talking here a lot about the context of hackathons and makerspace and firms. And I would just want to drop that question of who's able to participate on those hackathons and the importance of persons with disability to come up with solutions. And I want to share this image. And this is an innovation from India, and it's a walker for stairs. And the walkers is a technical solution for persons that have problems to walk. Yeah. But they often cannot walk upstairs or downstairs. Would you know who developed this solution? The idea came from a girl at in year 8. She saw her grandfather or grandmother that couldn't go upstairs and downstairs, and she came up with her own design of how it could work. She had designed something that had that you can extend the leg in the front or the at the back, depending if you were going upstairs or downstairs. Of course, what she designed didn't look like this. This final design came through the support of innovation organization, the Indian National Foundation, which tries to support grassroots innovations. So I wanted to highlight here the importance of also who participates in the design of those technological solutions. And I will just stop there. Those are my two thoughts for today, food for thought. And if you want to follow up more on the work that we do on promoting inclusive technology and innovation policies, there is a web link there. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mara. The second person I want to invite to talk is Maggie Goody. So the floor is yours.
Great, thank you. Thanks for inviting me. Thomas has asked me to speak to you specifically about the hackathon, the Hack of Health is what they call it. So because obviously I have a lot of experience with disabilities having Emma. We actually were involved 2 years in a row. The first year specifically, we had asked the team to develop an arm that Emma was going to be able to draw independently. So Emma, just so you, those of you obviously who don't know her, she was born in 2009 with cerebral palsy, and she actually has very limited mobility. She's in a wheelchair and she has very little fine motor skills. But she's extremely intelligent. And so she absolutely wanted to be able to be able to do her own, I would say, kids things and do some drawing by herself. So that was the project for 2019, was that the team was going to be building her an arm, literally, that we connected to her desk in her room, that was able to give her the freedom of mobility to be able to draw by herself. So that was the first year. And then the second year, this year, which was a little bit tiny but more complicated just because of the COVID reasons, but she herself asked to modify this same arm so that I guess she might have been kind of bored with the drawing thing. I don't know. But she wanted to actually do something very much independent, which was to feed herself. So Emma is not able to feed herself. And it's true that I think it's something that is close to her heart to be able to give herself her own, you know, her own nutrition. So that was her decision this year, was to change this, the same arm, and modify it to be able to feed herself. So I think from our experience, the 2 years, really, if I may say so, from our point of view, and kind of Marta, what you were saying earlier as well, for us as parents, and I'm sure Emma as well, but for us, what we really feel is that this is an amazing initiative, just because, like you said, with the barriers, Marta, I think as living with a person with a disability like Emma, we're always confronted with these barriers constantly, whether it be infrastructurally or just literally with the handicap itself or the disability itself, or you know, the mentality of people or the culture or et cetera. We're constantly fighting these barriers. And I think the Hack of Health literally was without barriers. It was really, you know, limitless. We could have decided anything we wanted to develop to help her. So that was really, I would say, something that, you know, is very rare for us to feel, is this sort of openness to say, okay, let's do something crazy, you know? So that, from our point of view, was really touching, if I can say. Then from Emma's point of view, I think what was really important for her is actually to be able to be heard. I think that especially a person with disabilities, and Martha, this may go with a little bit with what you said as well, is about including people with disabilities in your innovation projects, is, you know, a lot of these people, they live with their disabilities. They know what it is like. We don't know what it's like, although we can imagine it. Obviously, I live with her, but we don't know what it's like. So for her, the Hack of Health initiative was really an opportunity for her to say, no, this is what I want. This is what I need. And what I really want to maybe work on to increase my independence in the future. So giving her, obviously, her own empowerment over her own disability, which is huge. And, you know, I think on a daily basis, we're always saying, okay, you know, the orthopedists and the occupational health and parents and everybody were saying, okay, this is good for you. This is good for you. Okay. This is not good for you. Okay. And we're sort of managing her own disability, which this project was really able to let her speak, basically. So I think the positive things to take out of this project were specifically the spirit of the people. I think that it certainly stems from the organizers themselves and the energy that they have to do something for the wider good. So is kind of what I said earlier, you really feel like there's absolutely no prejudices, there's no preconceptions, there's really just everybody, and it creates this energy and this spirit that, yeah, that's, it's not often that we feel such an openness. So, and then the also another positive things with the organizers, obviously with their energy and the desire to do so, the organization is huge. I mean, they have done a fantastic job. And I think if people were to take this idea internationally, it's something that definitely needs to be taken into consideration. The organization with the access, with the, you know, it's over 48 hours. So you have to organize the food, the fun side. So they were actually organizing, they had a huge table of just games for the kids to play during the 48 hours. They organized snacks. They organized a television to watch cartoons. They organized everything. And also the communication around that as well. It's a huge, I'm sure all of you know, dealing with communication, it's huge to be able to communicate to the wider audience, not only the participants, but also the people with the disabilities who have their projects going. So, and as you mentioned as well, the organization around this sharing of the information and putting this online so that other people elsewhere can use these beginnings of these projects to continue on. So it's a huge organization. I think the group did an absolutely wonderful job. Also, I think for us as parents, well, as Emma as well, I think what really stands out for the Hack of Health is the connections that we made, of personal connections. I think that the spirit of the event brings in a certain personality of people who really want to do something for the greater good for, you know, people with disabilities, but not only. And I think it doesn't really matter about the skills that they bring, because there's a huge, you know, diversity of people, not only culturally, but, just in skills. Like, we had some robotics PhDs to a journalist to, you know, just anybody. So I thought it was important to bring out the diversity of the people here, because it's really people that stick in my mind and made it such a fantastic event. There was one person called PK who's actually a data scientist. This was last year. He really had no like skills, I would say, in robotics or anything, but he actually was able to make Emma a joystick in 45 minutes. I mean, in the 48 hours, he actually made her a joystick because he wanted her to be able to not only physically draw on a paper, but also physically draw on a computer. I guess as a computer buff, he knew the importance of wanting to probably draw on technology. And so he actually developed, not that we didn't even ask him, and he came up with this joystick to have her draw on the computer in 48 hours. And in fact, he was so engaged that he came over months after and actually made her a Wii command. You know, he actually built a Wii command so that she could do like this and actually draw on her computer. Also, we had this year, we had a young guy from Nigeria who actually works for the UN, and he doesn't have any skills in robotics or, you know, mechanical, anything. But he did have the interest to be there, and he actually sewed the entire, it was like it's an arm where there's a fabric over her arm, and he actually sewed the entire thing, and he just learned that from his mom in Nigeria. So things like that are extremely important. And then there was another man this year called Ahmed, who was actually at IT, living in Lyon, so 2 hours away from here. And he came back and forth to be able to be involved. And actually, he's coming over still now, what is it, a month and a half afterwards, to be able to complete the project. So just to give you an idea of the engagement that people have with this project, and I think it's absolutely amazing. And in fact, they were so engaged last year that the association that I'm president for, which is called Handicapable, we actually encourage inclusion through sports. And we actually organize an event called the Handy Challenge every year. Well, unfortunately, not this year because of the COVID, but several of the teams that were involved in the hackathon actually came back for the Handy Challenge. So just to give you a sense of the personality and the engagement from the people. I think some of the things, if you guys were to, and then I'll stop because I'm talking a lot. I think a few of the things that are something to be aware of is the preparation for these types of hackathon events. I think what was differed from 2019 and 2020 is that, obviously because of COVID reasons, nothing to do with the organization, is that in 2019, we were really able to prepare the project, Emma's project, beforehand, really having even, you know, before now, where we weren't so used to having these online video conferences. We actually had online video conferences at the beginning of last year to be able to prepare for the project. So that was really key, I think, in actually being able to hit the, you know, ground running when we actually, the actual hackathon started. Then also, I think another key point is to actually get the professionals involved. a lot of the people that come to this event are younger, maybe students or learning, you know, a certain discipline. I think what we have learned is that it's really important to get the professionals involved, and even beforehand, to start to like maybe even I would say let the participants know what actually exists in the market already or doesn't for their certain project. You know, if there was already an arm in the market that existed, how could they take that already existing arm and modify it to the actual project itself? And then why not have them actually there at the hackathon itself, not to do the projects, but actually just to increase the learning and the innovation and the knowledge transfer. Also, I think what is key is that we really need to get the haute école, like the professional schools, involved in this project. I think there's obviously a desire to, but you know, I don't know where, but I think that there needs to be more communication with the haute école, trying to get some of these maybe OT specialists, the robotics specialists, the anybody involved. And like I'm involved in another association where we actually have encouraged the OT students to get involved in the houses of people with disabilities. So actually they're getting credit. They get actually for 40 hours of time that they spend in the houses, caring for these people with disabilities, they actually are going back and getting credit in their school class hours. So maybe something to think about that. I don't know if there's a challenge to get people involved, or maybe just an idea. And then another last thing, and then I'll pass the microphone over to someone else, is another thing is how to follow up. Obviously 48 hours is not a lot of time to be able to complete such huge important projects. So really, you know, how to really formalize, I would want to say, how to formalize the follow-up is really important. And I think something that deserves further discussion.
Great, Maggie, thank you very much. And Najem, the floor is yours. Thank you for being here.
Thank you. I'm going to talk about a couple of projects that we have been doing in the Media Health Lab, and in general, the methodological sort of framework that is driving the work that we are doing. To start, this is the problem that we are trying to address. As researchers and as caregivers, we need to come up with technologies that are going to address the question of aging. Currently, we are in, this is our time, 2020, and there is as many 35-year-old individuals in the world as there are adults older than 65. But by the time that we, who are now on this panel, are reaching our senior years, there's going to be many less younger individuals to take care of us physically, emotionally, and economically. And so this is the problem that is motivating and actually pushing for a trend about the future of care. And a lot of us, especially those of us who are engineers and technology makers, are claiming that the future of care is going to be digital. And the question that we ask is, should that be so? And this pandemic, in fact, has been a very good is not the right word, but it has been an occasion for us to question some of these assumptions that we've had about the role of technology in providing care for older adults. So the promises are telehealth, rehabilitation, socialization, breaking the isolation, assistive robots, and autonomous living and ambient living spaces. But of course, we are still grappling with human factors, the safety, efficacy, accessibility, and the experience of users of these technologies. And of course, the social factors of inclusivity and equity, they are less in the imagination of a lot of engineers who are designing these technologies. That's where we need social scientists to actually come and help. So in the Media Health Lab, the work that we do is inspired by the neuroscience of stress and the fact that chronic stress is going to have negative health consequences. And in the Media Health Lab, we try to develop technologies, media technologies that are interactive and playful. And this is the theoretical model that we work with. Any organism from the most basic to advanced, the garden worm to, you know, to an intelligent human, they rely on metabolism in order to function. And then this metabolism relies on the ability to move and sense the environment and also gather the rewards and avoid dangers as we are surviving day to day. And this process requires attention to tasks and to activities that are going to give us the skills that we need to gather these rewards and to feed our metabolic needs on a constant basis. And this is why we need memory, and that's how we are learning. And we argue that this is the zone that we can sort of mediate the stress of living, the stress of illness and disability, via play, which is sort of creating this augmented environment in which we can manipulate the reward system through media technologies that would be interacting with our learning, skill development, skill sharing, and also sensation. But the question that we are also interested in is whether these technologies are helping or hurting. We started with this question of games and the prevalence of playfulness using digital means for older adults. And we did a set of studies in a study that was called Finding Better Games for Older Adults. This was a participatory project initially in phase one. It was a quantitative study, and the objective was to ask whether confrontation or being introduced to a new technology is going to be physically, biologically, physiologically stressful to older adults. That led us to learn that, in fact, the biggest stressor was the fact that most older adults were not familiar with the technology. So in phase two, we set up a program to actually teach them about serious games and then how games work and whether they would be useful for them. And in phase three, we were more interested in older adults participating and having a conversation about the serious games and their affordance or their lack of in their lives. So in the very first study, we found that yes, indeed, confrontation with these new technologies was physiologically stressful, depending on what kind of game they were playing and what were their perceptions of the medium that was presented to them, whether it was useful, whether it was meaningful, and so on and so forth. What we also found is that this relationship is complex and is heavily mediated by not only the cognitive and emotional reserves of individuals, but also their physiological ability, their physiological baselines. I'm not going to go into these details. You can read these papers. They're all open access. But the most important take-home message from this two-year-long project was that there is a lack of intergenerational understanding of the needs and the motivations of different groups. So initially, when we came to these 100 hours of conversation, we had a population of younger students. So first, I have to mention that the first problem that we had, there were not enough young people from our game programs who were interested in participating in this kind of work, despite the fact that we were paying students as research assistants. Only few joined us. And the other was the misunderstanding in terms of the affordances of games and then what games are. For the young generation, games are a medium of communication. These are their new novels, their new films, their new, their new books. But for the older generation, they are a waste of time of the younger adults. So in this conversation, we identified that a need for conversation is actually more important and more pertinent to everyone. The other thing that we learned is that people who are participating in this kind of research are not necessarily representative of the aging population. It's mostly people who have access to these technologies or the time or the physical and mental ability to participate in design with us. And the generational stereotypes, I did talk about them, but in terms of what these individuals liked in terms of these media for their cognitive, emotional, and social experience was the virtual reality. So we set up a living lab in a shopping mall to sort of bring our work into the public and to ask, you know, to sort of open it to a larger population who are not coming to our fitness center, basically, for participating in these academic studies. And again, virtual reality was quite popular. And then we were hit with the pandemic. And that's when we realized that, you know, all these technologies that we are talking about are actually quite quite dangerous. I could not go and put my headset on anybody's head. Now we have moved all of these activities to the Facebook. And there we are confronted with the challenge of keeping people engaged with Zoom. That is a very difficult experience, especially with the heterogeneity of individuals who are coming to these online sessions. Some cannot hear well, some cannot see well, some do not understand my accent. So each of us have different kinds of limitations. But at the same time, everybody is pushing, and especially we are now scraping the Facebook and Reddit and Twitter just to see what people are saying. And then everybody's pushing these technologies, especially virtual reality, for the well-being of the older adults. Now, of course, when it is feasible to sort of introduce virtual reality to them, in one of the largest studies that I have found so far, it seems that the experience of virtual reality is not necessarily. So these are in paleo have what these older adults experienced before going into a VR session and then after. They feel less rested and less curious after they try it. And ironically, although we are promoting these for their breaking isolation, they seem to make individuals more tired and also more lonely. These are the questions that we need to be asking when we are pushing technology into the lives of older adults. And so what is the next step in introducing any new medium to the lives of anyone? I think it's safe to go with the laws of media by Marshall McLuhan and his time. And the question is that we have to ask, what is it enhancing or intensifying? What is it rendering obsolete and or displaces? What does it retrieve that was previously obsolete? And then if we push it to the end, what happens? And in investigating this question, we sort of definitely have to take a participatory approach, but we also have to have some form of an evaluation method that is grounded in objective variables. And so in this framework that we proposed in effective game planning for health application, we start with the needs. Those needs are actual medical needs of individuals, but then we have to spend a good bit of time to evaluate the importance of these technological and medical innovations against the desires of the individuals who are interacting with them. And of course, there is a long list of methodological the methods that are at our disposal. And actually, there are open science platforms existing that can facilitate the sharing of the data across these heterogeneous studies that we are doing around the world. So unifying these studies is going to provide us enough data to actually understand what is happening better. So in closing, I want to thank the numerous centers and programs and entities that have been supporting this work that I talked about. It's of course would not have been possible without the participation of our enthusiastic grannies who came and played with us. The work was done at Perform Center and supported by the Milieu Institute of Arts and Engage and also TAG. And MSIN is where we have the host of open science platforms that I hope we would be sort of adapting into our technological developments. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Najam. Very, very, very interesting work and presentation. I want to invite Bettina Feldman from Fondation Fides to actually take the floor.
Thank you. Just to give you the context, we are currently building one of the biggest social innovation hub in Europe, gathering 9 of the main social enterprises in the Geneva State and Republic. Amongst our social enterprise partner, you have like organization with disabled people, with people with a mental health problem, as well as elderly. And what brings them together, or at least the common denominator, is that they are really including disabled elderly within their co-activities that can be commercial or not. What I have discovered while building this hub is how important in terms of innovation and social innovation is to create links between different worlds that it's not that they ignore each other, they just don't know the other exists. And I have a very specific example of creating a link between Claire Bois, which is a foundation dealing with disabled people, and ACA Health and the Campus Biotech. And basically there were 10 kilometers between these two institutions and they just didn't know one another exists. And they end up finding solutions for a young person that is in Clairebois. So just to really explain how complicated it is to create connection, even within, you would say, a small city like Geneva. I was quite touched by what Marta said in her speech about the stigmatization of disabled people in Asia. The social enterprise Trajet that is dealing with mental health just had his 20th birthday. And the innovation of the founder was just to realize that if you keep disabled people in one single area, therefore they are not going to live and be normal citizens within the city. So the innovation of Trajet was basically to build not only houses, but also social enterprises within the town in order to give visibility and a sense of utility for disabled to be part of the city agenda. So this was 20 years ago, Marta, and the floor is yours in Asia. Another example, in order to go, I would say, beyond innovation, is really a matter of education and educating the very small children about disability. And another example in our city is with the Ensemble Foundation, and they basically brought their own children in regular school children. And this means that there are no barriers between disabled children and, so to speak, normal children. Maggie, sorry if I'm not if I don't use the correct word. And again, I think that when we talk about innovation at large, There are many different levels of innovation. Technology is for sure very important and will be more and more important, but creating the links between the skills, the world, and the needs on the ground seems to be really important. And in this regard, I would say that the HKLs is a very interesting tool that in a way fulfill a number of criteria that helps, but nevertheless, and I don't record who mentioned it, how to formalize the result, how to make it open source, and in a way not to reinvent the wheel, but really try to scale up what has been identified as a solution for one single human being, and how to replicate seems to, for me, the biggest innovation we could all look after.
Thank you very much, Bettina, for this back to the ground speech. My first question is goes to Najem. I wonder if you can reflect a bit further on the centrality of gaming in this situation for this instance of aging and disabilities abroad.
I think so far what we have found is that the games their meaning to especially to the older adults are different than to younger ones. So if you're presenting a game to them that has a specific benefit, a specific health benefit, then they seem to be interested in engaging with it. But I think that is not an engagement that is going to continue for very long. Older adults are playing games to pass time, to avoid boredom, to relax. But then if they want to do a cognitive enhancement or physical rehabilitation, they prefer to do actual activities. They prefer to knit, to have conversation, to have social interactions over games. This is something that they have been telling us over and over again. However, we have to sort of separate games from playfulness. Playfulness is important to them. Playfulness has an element of experimentation and socialization, and that is not necessarily a gamified approach to health. In the gamification, we are focusing on reward as a mechanism that is driven by a goal. So for instance, if I am to tell somebody, if you're going to play this game, you're going to improve your memory, I'm immediately putting a lot of stress on them by raising the expectation that if they don't do well, if they don't improve their memory, then there is something that's wrong with them. So, and then that's when usually people quit these things. This is why a lot of us are starting these, using these apps, but then we give up very soon because we are not meeting the goals that the app is setting for us. So I think playfulness is very important. Gamification is something that needs to be nuanced a little bit. And I think that's what we are working towards, quantifying what are the elements that would make a playful activity also gameful, and whether gamefulness is necessary for health applications. I hope I answered your question.
Yes, thank you very much. It's great. Very substantial response. I was not expecting that much, so thank you so much. My second question goes to Maggie. You get a very great experience during a hackathon. This hackathon happens to be very compassionate because it has been designed this way to be really centered around the person who is experiencing the who is disabled, and I was there physically. You see really engineers, designers, journalists, whoever, just around the disabled person for 48 hours and asking this person, what do you need actually, how can we help you, and then coming and bootstrapping, oh, I tried that, can you try, what do you think of it, and so on. But then what we could just do to push the envelope and to make that even more efficient and long-lasting and meaningful.
It's sort of been for us dependent on the participants itself in the team, in Emma's team. So luckily we've had last year and this year individuals in the team that have actually been really engaged. And so they actually came on their own time afterwards. But I think it does, like I said, definitely need to be formalized. I had this conversation last night with my husband, and we were wondering if, you know, it's the idea of a 48-hour time frame is really interesting. I think it brings motivation. I think it brings a sense of urgency that I think brings a certain energy to the event. But I'm wondering, I don't really have an answer to your question, Thomas, but I actually was wondering if there couldn't be sort of like maybe a second hackathon, but maybe not so visual, maybe not so communicated, but something that actually is still organized per se. So the participants have to come in a way, have to come. Nobody has to do anything, but they're encouraged to come and actually finalize. I don't think it needs to be actually a full hackathon where, you know, the communication is the same, but I think there does need to be maybe a second smaller event just to finalize. So it's not also on the shoulders of a few certain people that actually want to do it or have the time to do it.
Yes, it's a question for me. Thank you very much. Actually, you turned the question around. we could have a long discussion after hack, but the simple answer to your question is you during a hackathon, you're just loading a lot of intrinsic motivation. So it means people are really into that because they believe in that, and they're just going to deploy a lot of energy. And then it's a bit like a romantic experience in a way. You know, you get just a lot of adrenaline and it's really nice. And then, of course, at some point there's a decay, and this decay can be shorter or longer. So first thing is we want to maximize, to make this decay as low as possible. But then at some point, you know, the reality takes over. So if we want to have people engaged, we have to push extrinsic motivation. So we have to give people actually ways to actually get a benefit, which is more than just a pleasure. Otherwise, no, it's not going to work. So all the other way to go around is to actually reduce the cost of contributing. So on the long run, if it costs less and less to people to contribute more efficiently, then it's okay. When we look around good enough, so we spend enough time looking around, we can find all the solutions we need, basically, maybe with just an epsilon, a very slight difference between what we really need and what exists already. But the searching costs seem to be enormous. Do you have a trick? Do you have like a specific thing that you want to implement to make these bridges and these links between people in the most efficient way?
Question is whether I have une baguette magique. I don't. But coming back to this very specific period we all live, there were a lot of innovation within organization because of the crisis. And when talking about elderly people, it was the case at the Red Cross in Geneva also, how to basically bring food and support to elderly. Now, I believe that innovation came within the organization themselves. And I myself questioning how innovation lab can bring innovation at this time of a crisis. And my first answer is that innovation lab are not the best one to provide the best innovation in times of crisis inside organization or even amongst the beneficiary. Now, telling this, and I might say something totally different in 6 months, it doesn't mean that you don't need to gather the people in order to exchange best practices. And this is for sure one of the goals of the Fides Lab. But you need to find the motivation to share this experience, even though they don't have a direct, I would say, return on investment. And I think if we find this advantage, it will be important. And again, we see a lot of online sharing and how to grab this and make it really real for the people. It's also a question I put on the table. So sorry, Thomas, a lot of questions, not a lot of answer, but I believe that's the way innovation will come.
Lovely answer. That's perfectly fine. Thank you very much. One thing I remember is this question of motivation for people to get together. I have a last question for Marta. Actually, it's a question from Najme, which I'm going to take from the chat. Thank you for helping me in moderating, Najme. So the question is, does the stigmatization against disability also coincide with lack of care and social support?
I'm not an expert on disability in Asia Pacific, but I will just want to transmit what we've seen. That Asia Pacific is very broad, and countries are very different. So Singapore is very different from Thailand in terms, for example, of having infrastructure environment for persons with disability. One of the things that shocked me is you don't see persons, there's no need to develop wheelchairs because persons with disability don't go out of their house because their families are ashamed of them and they are secluded. So that's something that I felt very strongly. And this is a person that with disability and well-educated and sharing how he lives. And the other key issue that he points out is this about universal design and the design of cities. So in Bangkok, it's impossible to go on a wheelchair or even for children to push. It's impossible. There's no pavements. You have to go up and down all the time. The air train is one of the main means of moving, and only some stations have elevators, and they may be across the road where you are, but then you don't have a passage to cross the road. So that's it's all these environmental. And for example, Thailand is very good in health systems in overall in general, but it really does badly in terms of from what has been conveyed in terms of infrastructure and having this enabling, and then culturally in terms of stigma. There's a lot of I guess superstitions, and this is very cultural. But then each country will be different. And I have seen initiatives, for example, in Bangkok on integrating persons with disability. I'm not Thai and I don't speak Thai, so I don't know what's happening in the Thai world, but parents with persons with disability, they say there's a lack of healthcare, trained healthcare for persons with mental disabilities, and they often rely on a few expats that can provide those services here. And similarly, there are a few social enterprises that I'm aware working with persons with disability and that offer workspace and training, both in Thailand and in Cambodia, and they're all driven or set up by expats, by foreigners. But I mean, there may be more, but that's what I come across. Thank you for your questions.
Thank you very much, everyone. I think we are running a bit out of time. Really thank you for being part of this panel. This project is supported by the Swiss Confederation and the Swiss Embassy in China. as well as the Geneva Chingu Initiative at the University of Geneva, United Nations Institute for Training and Research, Open Geneva, and the Geneva Health Forum. So we get supported all over. That's great. Now, what I realized that in our mission statement, we have to actually do desk research on what are the most important problems that we have to solve for aging and disabilities. And now I realize that from this panel, we're not going to do any desk research. We're going to organize more panels because I took so many notes, so much great information, very practical information that that we could share today. And I hopefully it's going to enrich all of us, not only our project. And I'm really grateful for your presentations, for the substance of your presentation and for your testimonies. And yes, I also want to thank Fabio Bali, the leader of the Open Village, and also Aphrodite Anastasaki, who is intern at UNITA and at the University of Geneva, for amazing work putting up this panel together in, 5 days, something like that. So we've been quite agile there. So thank you very much, everyone. And have a nice rest of day or a nice breakfast for Najmeh. Thanks for joining us so early. Thank you very much.